Can I call the meeting to order and welcome everybody to Cabinet? Before we get into the agenda, just got a couple of announcements and issues I wanted to raise. I think first of all, I think it's important we just refer to the terrible tragedy in London at Grenfell Tower. Obviously, our thoughts and prayers and sympathies are with the families and the loved ones of everybody concerned in that tragedy. And I know there's a national minute signs at 11 o'clock, but can I just invite people to stand for a minute now, just in memory of all those people affected? Thank you.
Once the full facts are known. For now, our focus
just one of the general issue I wanted to raise before getting to the agenda. I think we need to. I would like to congratulate the people who got re-elected to represent the rural area members of Parliament on the 8th of June. I think without getting into the detail of this, I think from my point of view, a very clear message was sent from the people of Wirral. I hope the government is listening, and that message is austerity should not and cannot continue. It's not a viable policy, and we all know the consequences that we're having to deal with on a local level. So I will still certainly be writing to the Prime Minister. I know my other colleagues in the city region, the Steve Robin Metro Mayor, to demand really that austerity is reversed, and those vital public monies that have been stripped from our budgets over the last 7 years are restored, so we now can provide viable, good quality public services going forward. I think if there's any message that comes out of the general election, it's that message. Yeah. It is. Okay, on to the agenda. So item one is members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Do any members of the cabinet declare any interests? No? Okay, thank you. Minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that I sign them as a true record? Is that agreed? Stream. And I'm really excited. I'm actually really confident that we can deliver this because of the huge interest that we've had from developers and investors since we launched Rural Growth Prospectus in March. And I think that was a really important event for us to attend, and that's generated significant interest from the investor and development opportunity who see the wonderful opportunities in rural and want to be part of this partnership with us. So what are we doing today? Well, basically, by agreeing this report, we are agreeing to SPAC's growth committee, and secondly, kickstart the procurement process. To identify an investor and development partner. So emerging notice and all the appropriate procedures will be put in place. The aim will be to get to a position by the end of the calendar year where we've identified the partner, and I'm very confident that in the early part of 2018 we'll see the first phase in the ground, because at the end of the day this is all about delivering significant, meaningful economic growth at scale for rural. So the other point to make is that as part of the procurement process, and it's covered in the covering report on page 16, we will be setting out the need for the company that we work with to work with our local communities, to look at the importance of skill qualifications and apprenticeships in the local area, and ensuring that local developers and local suppliers also benefit from any regeneration. So what's called the council's social value duty will absolutely be to the fore in the current process. And certainly from a Labour group's point of view, that's absolutely critical to our kind of principles around all this. So I think this is a really exciting opportunity. I think this is a really important report. As it says in the documentation before you today, we'll have a further report back to Cabinet before we agree the final deal in terms of the partner, etc., etc. But I think it is important that we get this process underway so that the brightest and the best in terms of investors and architects and developers can come forward and put their case to why we should select them. So I think it's a really exciting opportunity. And I would commend the Cabinet to support these recommendations, which are included in the report on pages 12 and 13. Okay, any comments, any questions? Jan?
Selling it, which means that in addition to bringing in revenue, which is totally groups and had representatives from them as well. I'm pleased we had that. I'd like to again extend my thanks, I've done in there, but actually to all of those engaged over the last 12 months. We've had various meetings and spotlight sessions. I know we had a meeting of councillors a few months ago as well, so I feel that we've really got the weight of the good to contribute their ideas to this. And for me, there are three major priorities coming out of this strategy. We need to inspire more involvement. Those that only do a little bit, they are inspiration to those that aren't doing that and might want to get involved. We should encourage them, make it as easy as possible for people to do more volunteering. Explain what opportunities are out there at the moment. And I know I've spoken with Kevin and Bertrand and his team about that being pushed out there more through our communication channels. And finally, removing barriers. The New Brighton Inn is a wonderful group. Chris, obviously, is the Council of Ward. And I was with them on Saturday for a great get-together. What they've done is quite magnificent. And what I think, where they've had a really positive relationship with the council is we've known when it's time for us to back off and leave them to get on with things, and we've known when to step in and provide that support. And I know they work closely with their councils as well. So I'm really keen that we draw those three things out of this strategy, and that we can lead to some real positive involvement across rural and our communities over the next few years. So I move the recommendation on page 95 that we approve the strategy.
Okay, thanks, Matthew. Anybody else want to comment? I've got Chris and then Bert.
Thank you, Phil. I'd just like to say that as the pledges are moving on, we can see so many overarching things. And the volunteering is such a huge issue, for instance, in the Young People's Pledge, in the Healthy Lives Pledge. And I think it's really great that we've got some business to be here about volunteering.
Okay, thanks, Chris. Bertie?
Just to add to that, because I work in the voluntary sector and work with volunteers, the world has an awful lot of volunteers who are professional people who have retired and who want to give their services to help others. So this strategy is really, really important because we've got so much talent here that people don't want to lose. So obviously having volunteers costs money as well, so you don't have them for nothing, but you have to create an environment where volunteers can come to and be safe and be nurtured as well. So I welcome this, I think it's excellent. And you're right about the barriers. The most important thing for volunteers is that we enable them to volunteer, not put barriers in their way to stop them from doing so. And they're the ones with all the great ideas, and we just need to be able to enable them to get on with their ideas. This is a great strategy, so that will help us.
Okay, thank you
very
much, everybody. Okay, can I just add my support for this strategy? I mean, I think it's a really, and for me, there's a clear action plan at the end of it in terms of what we've been doing. As you say, there's fantastic work that goes in from volunteers, but there's lots of people, as you say, if they were given the opportunity, who don't volunteer and would like to. So I think this plan for getting more and more people to get involved in various local projects is a great one, and it will help us deliver the rural plan. I think that for me, it will, and it can cost a huge amount because people are prepared to give up their time for the benefit of the local community. So definitely a very positive move forward. So thanks, Matthew. So can we agree the strategy, which is appendix to the report, is that agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much. Great, thank you. Takes us on to item 6, rural residents live healthier lives, tobacco control and alcohol strategy. So this is Chris Jones.
Thank you, Phil. We all know that we have a huge health inequality in Singapore, and that's one of the reasons we mentioned the pledges we originally thought about. The Healthy Lives Pledge says that we want all of our residents to have a good quality of life and live healthy lifestyles in convenient and safe environments. To have the best chance of improving their health, residents need to know what they're facing, what their options are, and where to go to help
item, if I can ask people to turn to page 123, recommendation is that before we approve the tobacco control and strategies, is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thanks very much. Okay, so item, moving on to item 7, rural visitor economy strategy. Phil?
Okay, thanks Phil. I'm delighted that your team to bring forward such exciting and important proposal. First, knowing what we're already planned, it's a once in a generation opportunity to really give us some sustainable economic growth for our borough. A vital element to this is going to be building on the success of our visitor economy, which continues to grow and will also be a thriving destination in its own right. We've got southern coast, countryside, world-leading cultural attractions, and the only Michelin-star restaurant and five-star hotel in Merseyside. We're perfectly positioned between Liverpool, Chester and Manchester, so it's little wonder that we're the fastest growing visitor economy in the city region. It's a fantastic achievement. But I'm eager to build on this, and a lot of people are too. This ambitious strategy sets out how we can attract thousands more visitors to enjoy more every year, enabling us to deliver massively upon our pledge. Strategy has been developed in collaboration with industry experts, local businesses and partners. They've used skills and expertise to develop a robust, challenging and ambitious action plan, which will deliver in partnership over 3 years. Strategy is expert-led, and it's a product of great minds committed to delivering great things. Not least achieving our target of delivering a tourism economy worth £450 million by 2020. It sets out four ambitious priorities, and we'll count to the room. I'll just go through them very briefly. We're going to relaunch rural's tourism marketing strategy, positioning the future as an outstanding destination. In this, we'll promote our borough as a fantastic tourism destination to national and international markets by developing attractively presented packages and products and being inviting to visitors. Two, generating greater benefit from conferences, business meetings and events. We'll have established rural as a regional conference and business destination. We're perfectly located to this, as we are next to the Port Manchester. Three, we'll develop rural tourism assets and experiences to increase competitiveness and attract new visitor markets. We'll create unique venues and open spaces to deliver blockbuster events like those most recently seen across the Mersey and maximise the benefits of our location and connectivity to places like Liverpool, Chester and Manchester. There's no reason whatsoever that rural can't become cultural in this region, and that's what we need to aim for. Four, encourage sustainable and accessible tourism in rural. We'll make sure existing and new attractions are modernised with new technology and improved accessibility to ensure that rural's rich heritage and spectacular assets are sustainable and preserved for future generations to enjoy. This exciting expert-led strategy will ultimately make rural a place where more blockbuster events are hosted, more businesses seek to invest, and more people wish to visit. In closing, Chair, I've met the authors of this impressive document. They're professional, compassionate, and dedicated. There's a real buzz around what can be achieved. Now, the vision is ambitious, but it should be ambitious. And I share that vision, and like that, I'm impatient to be able to see it delivered. I want to place on record my thanks, and the thanks of the cabinet to all the experts, and the local businesses, and regional business leaders who've given them their time and lent their expertise to help us create this truly exciting strategy to increase tourism in the world. I'm confident that the cabinet's approval can drive the strategy forward and deliver on our pledge. I'd like to move recommendation found on page 118 for agenda item 7.
Okay,
thanks,
Phil. Any comments on this? Chris? You have a Chris?
thanks, Phil. Just a great feedback, great summary of where we're up to with our strategy about tourism and visitor economy. Thanks, Phil. And just to say, I mean, what's really, really hard about this work, I mean, and as other Chris mentioned before, a lot of cross-cutting themes are coming through.
Yeah.
Certainly, at a meeting attended by the woman in charge of the Arts Council for the North of England, Jane Beardsworth, which she came to the room and was very impressed with our obviously library. She was indicating that these are two big pieces of work, two big ways forward. One is about skills development around art, culture, creativity, but the other one is the cultural visitor economy. That's going to be massive. We're going to be attending a meeting with Phil Redmond this week as well. So you know, we're totally in the right place at the right time. And I can only agree that our ambition. ambition, it has to be, you know, really, you know, a strong ambition, and we will really be able to deliver on this. That's really good. Thank you.
Bill, can I just say, if we didn't miss me, I want to give credit to Chris for the work she's been doing on the culture. It's not awesome, it starts to bear fruit.
Great, okay, thanks. I mean, a couple of things I just wanted to say on this report, which I fully support. I mean, sometimes I don't think people appreciate the importance that the visitor economy plays to Wirral. You know, 385 million in terms of income, supporting over 5,000 full-time jobs. It is a hugely important sector to us. And, you know, we ignore it at our peril, I think. And the aspiration to increase the value of the visitor economy to 450 million by 2020, and then 550 million by 2025 is absolutely right. We have 8.2 million annual visitors. That is staggering. It really is staggering. And that's up by 26% since 2010. So it is a hugely important and growing opportunity for us. Just anecdotally, my son got married on Saturday, and we had visitors from all over the UK and abroad to come to Wirral, and they were absolutely blown away by this place, and said, you know, you really should promote it more effectively, and that's one of the things that we need to do. But it is a hugely important area for us, this visitor economy, and I think it's absolutely right that we've got a plan to do that. So I'd like to thank, you know, all the colleagues from the council, Phil and Chris have been involved, but also our colleagues in organisations like the Chamber of Commerce, who have been very, very centrally involved in taking this forward. And I think it is exciting the times now for the visitor economy, particularly if, again, people are linking everything to the growth report, but, you know, this needs to be linked with the regeneration opportunities, because by promoting Wirral as a place where people want to come and work and invest, the quality of life factor is absolutely critical to getting people to come here. So this is such an important report. So Phil's moved the recommendation that we support this strategy. Is that agreed? Thanks very much. Okay, and that takes us then to item 8, our final item today, which is car parking charges, traffic regulation order, consideration of further representations. Stuart, can you take us through this, please?
Thanks, Bill. I'm seeking support the cabinet today to agree to modify the traffic regulation order so that we can implement a modest increase in parking charges at our car parks and reduce modest car parking charges in our future parks. Also, by agreeing with the recommendations of the report, we can begin upgrading our infrastructure so we can start accepting cashless payments for car parking. I'm sure I speak for everyone on this table and the other group that I didn't come to the politics to do anything or that to improve people's lives. So it is with a heavy heart that I seek support from cabinet to implement these measures. The fact is, due to their ideological and political choice, they have made investments by the Tory party to implement austerity, which has led to the need for decisions such as this to be taken to help plug the £45 million gap in the council's finances this year alone. Shockingly, by 2020, the average spending power of their household for Tory councils will be £92 less than it was in 2010. Compared to the average rate of £440 per household for Labour councils. That's 5 times higher. Even more shocking, here in Wirral, you'll have over £613 less to spend on public services per household in 2020 than we did in 2010. Wirral voters overwhelmingly rejected austerity in the ballot box on June 8th, so it's long overdue that the Tory group here in Wirral starts to listen to voters, get on top of the programme, oppose austerity, the third way that our fire service, police service, NHS and other public services are put to the bone. It's fair to say that the proposals we've the budget after we listened to the businesses and other objectives are substantially less than the original proposals, the increase and the carbon charges and also the country parks. as Cabinet Support Recommendations as set out on page 216 of the report, and I would also like to draw Cabinet's attention to 4.2 and 4.3 on page 208, which is sections of the report that we will deal with the objections.
Okay, thank you, Stuart. We will obviously note those objections. Can I just kind of amplify a couple of things you said? Why are we going to do this? We're having to do this because the government has slashed our budget by over 150 million since 2010 and another 132 million between now and 2021. If, as we hope, that policy is reversed, I would fully look forward to the government returning those missing millions to Wirral's budget, and I look forward to restoring all of these things. But until then, I'm afraid we've got still difficult decisions to make. But I think the ball is in the government's court. They either listen to the views of the electorate as represented in the general election, or they plough on with a very, very destructive policy of austerity. Let's hope they change direction. However, we've still got the council to run, we've still got the budget to balance, and this is one of the difficult decisions that we've got to make. But I do agree with Stuart, we have listened to the representations from residents and businesses. We have substantially reduced the charges from the original proposals. We've listened to businesses, we've listened to other groups like golfers and footballers. I think the £50 season ticket per annum is a good policy. And I think the important thing to stress is that money, in terms of the country parks, will be ploughed into making sure that we can continue to employ our rangers and do all of the stuff that we do in our country parks, which make them so special. I think the challenge I would make to those who say we shouldn't do this is, well, where are those savings going to come from? What is your only alternative to this? And I've not heard anything from the opposition on that front. I think the figures that you read out, Stuart, were pretty damning in terms of the loss of spending power. Tory councils, £92 per household less. Wirral, £613 per household less. That is a damning indictment of government policy. So sadly, we do have to